The Picnic by John Logan. It is the picnic with Ruth in the spring. Ruth was third on my list of seven girls, but the first two were gone, Betty, or else had someone. Ellen had accepted Doug. Indian Gully, the last day of school. Girls make the lunches for the boys, too. I wrote a note to Ruth in algebra class day before the test. She smiled and nodded. We left the cars and walked through the young corn, the shoots green as paint, and the leaves like tongues trembling. Beyond the fence where we stood, some wild strawberry flowered by an elm tree, and Jack in the pulpit was olive ripe. A blackbird fled as I crossed and showed a spot of gold or red under its quick wing. I held the wire for Ruth and watched the whip of her long striped skirt as she followed. Three freckles blossomed on her thin white back underneath the loop where the blouse buttoned. We went for our lunch away from the rest, stretched in the new grass, our heads close over unknown things wrapped up in wax papers. Ruth tried for the same, I forget what it was, and our hands were together. She laughed, and a breeze caught the edge of her little collar and the edge of her brown close hair that touched my cheek. I turned my face into the gentle fall. I saw how sweet it smelled. She didn't move her head or take her hand. I felt a soft caving in my stomach, as at the top of the highest slide when I had been a child, but was not afraid, and did not know why my eyes moved with wet as I brushed her cheek with my lips and brushed her lips with my own lips. She said to me, "Jack, Jack," different than I had ever heard, because she wasn't calling me, I think, or telling me. She used my name to talk in another way I wanted to know. She laughed again, and then she took her hand. I gave her what we both had touched, can't remember what it was, and we ate the lunch. Afterward, we walked in the small, cool creek, our shoes off, her skirt hitched, and she smiling, my pants rolled. And then we climbed up the high side of Indian Gully and looked where we had been, our hands together again. It was then some bright thing came in my eyes, starting at the back of them and flowing suddenly through my head and down my arms and stomach and my bare legs that seemed not to stop in feet, not to feel the red earth of the gully, as though we hung in a touch of birds. There was a word in my throat with the feeling, and I said, "It's beautiful." "Yes," she said. And I felt the sound and word in my hand join the sound and word in hers, as in one name said, or in one cupped hand. We put back on our shoes and socks, and we sat in the grass a while, cross-legged, under a blowing tree, not saying anything. And Ruth played with shells she found in the creek as I watched. Her small wrist, which was so sweet to me, turned by her breast, and the shells dropped green, white, blue, easily into her lap, passing light through themselves. She gave the pale shells to me and got up and touched her hips with her light hands, and we walked down slowly to play the school games with the others.